friends on this our certified high frequency structure simulator HFSS course. Today I'm going to talk to you about the applications of microwaves. Already I have discussed with you in my lecture 1 microwave along with the EM spectrum and the fundamentals micro components. Now I'm going to talk to you about the microwave applications of microwaves. They are the following applications that microwaves are used. One is industrial, then biomedical, communication, remote sensing and planetary exploration. In industrial application, basically we use microwaves for the heating part, which I just tell you in the next slide, that we use it for heating the paper and pulp, then tea and coffee, tea leaves and coffee seeds, then preservation of food, then the manufacturing of synthetics, then wood processing, baking, foundry cores. Then all these applications that you see here on this one are basically where we use microwaves as a heater, and they do the heating, and then like the curing and breaking of the concrete and the sealing of plastics. So all this, so we do microwave heating. In this case, then also we can use the microwaves for measuring the thickness of the metal sheets, the rolling mills, and wire diameter, then thickness measurement of dielectric sheets, monitoring of moisture content in the paper and textile, and measurement of moisture content in the liquid. Basically, the industrial application, the frequency used is 2450 megahertz. That is 2.45 gigahertz is one frequency that is mostly used, and another frequency that is used is 915 megahertz. And so that means these are the two frequencies which are used at various applications. Where we need larger penetration, then we go for 915 megahertz, and where we are satisfied with the smaller penetration for heating, then we use 2.45 gigahertz. And this allows to process materials with correspondingly larger dimensions, and penetration depth of microwaves is usually order of units and tens of centimeters and even more depending upon the material. Then advantages of this heating is that we use this gives us very accurate and controlled quantity of heating, then reduction in the heating time, then high uniformity and quality of the products, improvement in working conditions, and most important thing is there is no flue gas, any smoke or dirt when we use microwaves. Then the total space requirement is also reduced because of this. Then easy maintenance of the equipment, easy operation. Then automatic heating, and we need only semi-skilled people for operation. And most important is the economy. We reduce cost of heating and increase production rate. These are very, very important positive aspects of microwave heating. This is a process where how the heating takes place. The microwave coupling with the water molecule, and then H2O, and then the movement of molecules generates heat, and then this heat is used for drying the objects. Then when we use microwaves and RF heating, in RF we need larger power, 50 kilowatts of power, and RF heating is applied when a deep penetration is required. I told you earlier also, I compared the two frequencies, 2450 megahertz and 915 megahertz, and I said that 915 megahertz gives you better penetration depth as compared to 2450 megahertz, and so that is where RF heating has advantage when we need this type of requirement, that we need a deeper penetration and deeper heating. Otherwise microwaves gives you very suitable the radio frequencies, and output power density is very high, and they have a lower tendency to induce electric arcing that could burn the processed material at generator tube too. So this is advantage of microwaves as compared to the RF heating. Then I already mentioned that how molecules, microbes interact with the food, and then we talked about that dipole water molecules, and with ions they try to follow the direction of the electric field, and then this helps us the process of heating. In this case, the radio waves, they go inside the food material as a refracted wave, and some portion is reflected also. So that depends upon the type of material that we are having. So we have both the processes, reflection and refraction of microwaves at the interface between air and the food material. Now, the penetration depth is related to the dielectric constant of the material. And so, if you see here, that the dielectric constant of the water is highest among all these materials listed here. And the loss factor that helps us in heating part, the potato is maximum, the 24. And the 10 delta as well as the depth in millimeter is given in this table at 2.45 megahertz, gigahertz, sorry, or 2450 megahertz. Now, this is just a pictorial view where we are showing that how the heating takes place from the center and uniform heating all along up to the surface. That is beauty of the microwaves. And same thing is shown here, same thing here, starting from the center and then it heats up to the surface. And heating food from the center to the corners is only with the microwaves that we can get. In other heating, it is from the surface to the center, and then it is not uniform. In this case, it is uniform. The same pictorial, multi-component ready meal, where we are showing uni-component ready meal, before and after, and this is before and after. Then this is how the heating is done. You see here, this is the material which has to be heated, and that it has to go inside, and this is a conveyor belt, which is shown here in better way. So this material goes inside and the microwaves are put on this, and then with the effect of microwave, this material gets heated up. And this baking of the bread is taking place. And here we do a chamber dryer. So you put the material here and then you dry the material, and we use magnetron here. With 30 kilowatts of power and drying of the grinding wheels that is done here. Then again, as already told you, these are the different materials to be heated up or dried. They are, we'll put on the conveyor belt here. It goes inside and there is a microwave antenna and the transmitter is kept there by which you pass the microwaves. And then they go through the material and they heat the material and they dry it because of the heat. And these are various industries where they are used, aerospace, then polymer, then medicine and biomedical also, the construction of building material, building industries, then machinery and tools, paper industry, agriculture industry. Here is what I have been telling you earlier. This is a conveyor belt and this is where the spiral loop antenna is kept. This is spiral loop antenna, this is simple loop antenna, proposed spiral loop and traditional rectangular loop antenna. So they are kept here and through this the microwave radiation goes up on this and then this gets material gets heated up. So this type of antenna, so I just want to request you, if you are interested in this type of work where you want to help the industry and you think of designing such antennas, through our simulation and fabricating them and testing them. So I will be telling on the last day about the fabrication and testing, and what is important here is that we will help you if you are interested in fabricating such antennas, testing them at our place and giving the results to you. Those who are interested in this type of work, they can further stay with us and get the training on this one also. This is especially for all those who learn HFSS. Then we look at the biomedical applications. Now I want to again emphasize here, I am talking about applications, but my aim here is to tell you what kind of antennas are used for these applications, so that you keep in mind when you design an antenna, fabricate, so you know that this antenna will be used for what application. That is what is important. Now these are various areas where this microwave can be used: cryotherapy, detection of cancer, cure of cancer, treatment of hospital waste. And there again, by heating, bioheat, transfer of heating, use of applicators, use of microwave diathermy, minimization of leakage radiation, heating of lossy dielectric, and conversion of electric field energy into heat. And what is important here is the microwave is non-invasive. It is not invasive. We work as non-invasive, so that is most important thing. Any other technique will be invasive, whereas microwave diathermy is always non-invasive. We would like to work in, we can do invasive also, but then it's always better to work on the non-invasive. Then microwave radiometry for early detection of subsurface cancerous growth or tumors. Then microwave diathermy or hyperthermia, monitoring of frozen organs, rewarming infants after hypothermia, detection and monitoring of inflammation using microwave techniques. Then application to the cancer detection. We use microwave radiometry to detect subsurface or subcutaneous and even intracarnial thermal abnormalities using microwave radiometry. The resulting thermogram may be suitably interpreted to perform diagnosis on the thyroidal, orbital and intracranial pathologies. These are all applications. Then you have the tumors on the neck or the brain, arthritis and detection of breast cancer in women. Then use of X-rays. Here I would say that all the X-rays are used, but we should not go for this because there are radiation hazards. So we should always avoid X-ray for diagnostic method. We should always go for microwaves. Now, detection of cancer. See, when I was at SAC, I myself conducted this experiment using the radiometer that we developed, 19 gigahertz radiometer we developed for Bhaskara, Samir, and another radiometer we made at 1.4 gigahertz. And these two radiometers, here important thing is, for 19 gigahertz radiometer, we use this open-ended waveguide as an antenna. That was scanning the guinea pigs and trying to find out which are the parts of the guinea pig which are affected for the cancer. And for the 1.4 gigahertz radiometer, we used coaxial line as the antennas. And then these two we studied, and we were able to detect output in case of cancerous mouse due to high rate of metabolism in cancerous tissues. So we were able to detect cancer using these two type of radiometers at National Institute of Occupational Health at Ahmedabad. That was done in 84-85 using the radiometers developed for Bhaskara satellite. Now for treatment of cancer, we put applicators, conformal applicators for the treatment of the breast cancer, and then we also take and tubers using bean bag applicators also. So I just want to tell you, either we have conformal applicators or we have bean bag applicators in crossfire beams. Then hypothermia can also be a valuable complementary method for treatment of superficial management lesion up to 3 centimeter in thickness. So this is another application of microwaves. But what I want to emphasize here is, the antennas that we use here are the bean bag applicators. There is this bean bag applicator and cross beam fire, and another antenna we use is conformal applicator, which I will show you. So So here is just showing that how the effect of microwaves will help you. So the red spot you see here is a cancerous spot, and after treatment with the microwaves, this red spot is gone and the cancer is gone. Same thing here also, in this you see red spot, and after treatment with microwaves, then this has gone, and so there is no cancer. So that is the effect of how microwaves can cure the cancer. Now, advantages, disadvantages, we can focus energy, we can have simulation tools, low cost. And the disadvantage is resolution is poor. And then again, depth of penetration depends on the frequency, which we have talked earlier. Then sometimes EM interference, but then that can be taken care of by proper shielding and all that. If we shield the equipment properly, then we can take care of the interference. Then complex pattern of field in the body, scattering, individual energy. So these are it depends upon the human being who is being treated. So that is what is important here. Then the microwave that can be used here is from 100 MHz to 30 GHz. I have said earlier, the lower frequencies are good for penetration, depth of penetration, and higher frequencies are good for the surface phenomena. And so, tumor detection based on differences in tissue electrical properties, then regional hyperthermia, then application dot. So, these are various therapeutic applications based on the local heating, etc., using microwaves. Then, this is just an analysis based on the contrast dielectric property. We find 10% to 20% difference, and the tumors may have 2 times difference. It all depends upon the tumor and the type of tumor and location of the tumor. And this tumor detection is potentially attractive, and mammography, X-ray, as I told you, I think I will not advise here, but then we should be careful about it. But microwaves have advantage: electrical properties, accessibility, low attenuation, non-ionizing, that is most important. Microwaves are non-ionizing radiation, and so they don't have that much effect like X-rays and other things. Now, this is just how it helps. That use, this is transmitter here, and then this is the body, then the radio waves go through it, and these are the receivers. If here there is no tumor, so they just go and straight away go to this thing. But in the other case, there is a tumor, so there is a reflection and a scatter, and this the energy received back indicates that there is a tumor. And the energy which goes, the radiation which goes to the receiver, is reduced as compared to the other one. So from this we are able to detect the presence of tumor in the body with the help of microwaves. And this is just telling that we started in, this was in 1960s that this technique was developed, and people used MRI plus microwaves for as integrated system, and for superficial antenna arrays also conformal plus radiometry, both the things are used. Then for localized heating like prostate commercial system, and ablation, heart, liver, cornea and angioplasty. So these places when heating is required, we use microwaves for that purpose. Now here is, I think I request you to please note this point here. This type of antenna is used for the breast cancer detection, and these are patch arrays, patch antennas, and this is array of the patch antenna. And this circular antenna array, which gives you the side view, perspective view and the top view for the breast cancer detection. So those who are interested in medical applications, and I request that they can keep this in their mind, and this type of antenna they can design. And in the type of antenna, the double short distance slot antenna, this slotted antenna used for the treatment, antenna used in breast cancer treatment. Now, in conclusion, I just want to say, for diagnostic applications, very good results for the breast cancer detection, significant progress in many applications, clinical and commercial systems, progress in numerical modeling, new designs, and these are all, see, areas where we can work and improve the things whatever is available today. Then here I just want to show that microwave is also a hazard, and it could have thermal or biological or temporary or permanent effect. So thermal risk includes the simple heating of the human body as a result of microwave exposure. Here I want to mention that we should not worry about this so much, because it should be continuous exposure. If it is intermittent exposure, then microwaves will have no effect on you. If you are having continuous exposure more than half an hour, then you are likely to get affected by this. And what is biological effect will be induced mutations and chromosomal abnormalities in the plants and animals. So this we have to take care that they are not exposed continuously. Then the effect of hazards is a protracted radiation over the head, brain and spinal cord affects nervous system, resulting in convulsions and paralysis. So that we have to take care that we are not, again I am repeating, there should not be any continuous exposure of microwave. Then it develops gray cataract of the eyes. Then temporary or permanent sterility in males due to radiation effect on the organs. Upper exposure is standard for human tissues. Now this is the limit which is given here, 10 milliwatts per centimeter cube. It will be 10 milliwatt per centimeter square, area wise it is so. So this has to be corrected here. It has to be 10 milliwatt per centimeter square. Then as I told you already, prolonged low level radiation less than 1 milliwatt per centimeter square may also sometimes have detrimental effect. Prolonged low level, please note, prolonged low level radiation even less than 1 millimeter centimeter square can affect your body system. So please avoid prolonged radiation effect on you. Then periodic continuous monitoring of radiation level is important. Then avoid direct exposure to high power antenna beam, and appropriate measures to avoid leakage or stray radiation from the equipment. And we should take care that we don't get exposed continuously with the mobile towers, and that will affect our body system. Now here we did experiment on the guinea pigs, and we exposed them for 15 weeks, and we found that some effects were there on them. But if we had done much longer than that, then much more serious effects would be there. So the two animals were kept as a test element animals, and the other two were caged, and they were for controlled animals, and then PVC cage for the test animals. And then this is the setup. We transmitted energy from here through the horn antenna, and this is the cage, and this was received on this side. So we were able to know that how much energy was consumed here, and how much was scattered, and how much was absorbed by that could be monitored by us. And we found that the required larger duration of exposure to animals, and more analysis is required to find out the effect on this one. And here you can see that we could see tumor pathology could be seen in these animals because of the exposure of this one.